So good to see so many of you show up tonight. That's really cool. And just something to mention on these Wednesday nights, of course, the last Wednesday night of the month we'll still be together, so we won't do this. But on Wednesday nights, I'm planning on getting here by 6:15 and just spending some time in prayer, praying for the study, praying for our church, for our nation, and any particular needs. That if you need prayer for something, come at 6:15 on Wednesday nights, and we will, I'll have to figure out where we're going to meet, but you'll find us. We'll try to meet in here unless it's noisy. If it's just a few people, we can go meet in my office. But if you'd like to, I understand a lot of people, it's hard to get here at 7, but if you choose to be here, then we'll just have a time of prayer before this study, and I think that should be a really special time. Well, we're starting this new series on Wednesday night. I've been wanting to do it for a while, and I call it Need to Know, because we're learning all the time as people who are following Jesus, as Christians. But sometimes you get so much stuff coming in, and so often the things that people are telling you about, it might be interesting information, but it's hard to sort out, okay, what is really essential and what is it that's just interesting, could be even important, maybe not urgent, but what are the kinds of things that we would say, these are the basics, these are the things that we all need to be certain about. And so a part of my heart in going through this Need to Know series is for people who are maybe new to Christianity, or for people who just need a helpful review, people like me, it's been good for me as I'm going through and deciding what are the most important things that people ought to know if they're following Jesus. And after a few weeks, if you're like, I already knew everything Dave said, then maybe you don't need this class. But we want people to be able to come and just start from the basics and to know for certain what we as Bible-believing Christians believe and the things that are really important and that make us actually Christians. I'm going to try to avoid areas where people who are born-again evangelical Christians disagree, because I figure if there's somebody who totally loves Jesus and they believe something differently than I do, it must not be something that you need to know. We have a lot of fun talking about those things, and we deal with them when we go through Scripture, but we're trying to just go, what's a framework for what somebody who follows Jesus needs to have as the basis for their life? So I'm excited to do this series also, because then we will have it. It'll be on the webpage. Eventually, I'm going to write a workbook that'll go with it. And that way, at any point, when somebody comes along, they're new to the Lord, or maybe they've just been in a church that doesn't do a lot of teaching of the Bible, and they can latch onto this set and work through it. And so it's going to be a good resource, but I look forward to spending this time with you guys. And I will try to be really strict at ending it at 8 o'clock, because I know that, you know, all the good TV shows start then. So, no. I know if you cared about TV shows, you wouldn't be here. But I just want to be respectful of your time and mine. And so we're going to start tonight looking at basically the Bible. Why is it that we trust the Bible? Why do we believe the Bible? What is our basis for saying everything comes from the Bible? A lot of times, and especially if you've gone to different types of churches, maybe liturgical churches and stuff, where it's like the Bible isn't taught that much. It's other things are kind of taught. The Bible is sort of used, but, you know, maybe there's a verse and then there's boom, you know, 40 minutes of psychology or whatever. But why do we make such a big deal about the Bible? That's where it has to start, because everything else we're going to cover, like next week, Lord willing, we are planning on talking about creation and the fall, like basically what went wrong with our planet. And so we're going to base that on what the Bible says. So tonight I want you to understand why the Bible is such a big deal, why it's so important. In philosophy, there's a term that is called epistemology. And it doesn't you know, it doesn't, you know, the term isn't so important, but let me explain to you what it is. It's the study of how do you decide what's true and what isn't. I think we all have a sense that there is such a thing as truth. We may disagree with what the truth is, and I think, you know, there are a lot of people out there today who just say, I don't even believe in truth. If something can be true to you, but something else is true to me, and there is no absolute truth. To which I respond, so is that a true statement that you just said? Because if I can't know if there's truth or not, then I don't even know if you're right about the fact that there isn't truth. It becomes a circular problem. But everyone needs something, and it could be that which I have been taught, or it could be that which I grew up with, or it could be that which feels right to me. There are an awful lot of people for whom their epistemology is just, that sounds okay, or that doesn't feel quite right. But it's important if we're going to talk in a meaningful way about truth, then we need to know what's our basis for truth, what is our epistemology. And for a believer, and I'm going to propose to you, you don't have to buy it or not, that the Bible is our most dependable source and anchor for epistemology. The Bible is more dependable than what you feel like the Holy Spirit is telling you. The Bible is more dependable than what your pastor says to you. The Bible is more dependable than what has developed through church history. There are all sorts of, or what most people think. The Bible is something that is concrete and solid, and it hasn't changed, and therefore it's something that we can depend on more than any other source. It's not that some of these other sources can inform us, but if we're going to go for truth, we need to go for what the Bible says. Now, that presents problems because there are some things the Bible says that are just like, wow, I'm not sure what that means, or that seems kind of weird or whatever. But I'm operating under the presupposition that I don't judge the Bible. I try to understand the Bible. But if the Bible says something that sounds kooky, I'm still going to say, I don't know what it means, but I believe it. I am depending on this book as being the Word of God. Now, in order to see some of the reasons why, turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy is the last book that Paul wrote shortly before he was martyred in Rome. And so he's writing to Timothy, a younger pastor, and telling him the most important things. In a lot of ways, 2 Timothy is Paul's version of you need to know. It's like, here's stuff that matters. And so 2 Timothy 3, verses 16 and 17, he says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete or mature, thoroughly equipped for every good work. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. We use the term inspiration sometimes as being a term that means, wow, that is really special. We'll hear a song or we'll see a painting or read a book and we'll go, that was really inspiring. But that's not what he's saying. Literally what this says is, and you know that inspiration, the root of that word, the same as respiration, it means you're breathing. And inspiration is breathing in. So what Paul is stating here is all scripture, every bit of it, everything in the Word of God has been God-breathed, literally. God breathed the scriptures. It is coming directly from him. A lot of people don't want to believe that anymore. They see the Bible as a compilation of men's thoughts and ideas, and you kind of have to pick and choose. And I'll talk to you towards the end tonight about why that becomes such a problem. But I'm operating under the presupposition that everything in this book is inspired by God. And again, later on, I will explain why, even though certainly it's not the easiest thing to believe. But he defends it by saying it's profitable. You know, this book will help you in your doctrine, your teaching, basically. Reproof, it'll tell you when you're messing up, and correction, it'll give you the right path. Instruction in righteousness, the kind of stuff you ought to do, so that the person of God will be mature and equipped for every good work. So according to Paul, everything that we really need to live a complete and a healthy life is contained in this book because God breathed it. There is no other book that is similarly said to be, this book was God-breathed. That's a radical statement, but one in which I am just saying, if you don't believe that, if you don't accept that, because you go, how do you know that verse is inspired? I'm choosing to believe it. So I just want you to know that's my bias. You can judge later on as to whether you think that makes sense for you or not. But when we study God, the most reliable source we have is his God-breathed word. And so that's why that is. Now, if you look over at 2 Peter, which was Peter's last book that he wrote, he says something similar, 2 Peter chapter 1. And as an old man, these are the things that he felt were important. And look down at verse 20. He says, knowing this first. Well, in verse 19, he says, and so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. That word moved literally means we're carried along. So Peter is saying every bit of Scripture, it was not written as a human production, but God carried along holy people who wrote these words, and that's why it's so important. Now you might go, well, Peter, at the time he was calling Scripture, is he just talking about the Old Testament? Is he talking about his own writings? Where do you draw the line? We'll talk about that in a little bit. But Peter actually called Paul's writings Scripture. So he's including it because in the same context, he talking about Paul's writings, he says, you know, they're sometimes difficult, as are the rest of Scripture. So here's a statement from Peter. It's not just Paul, but it's Peter as well. Now, turn over to Matthew 5 and verse 18, because one of the most important things for us is how did Jesus regard the Scriptures, and because Jesus is the one we are actually following. And Matthew 5:18, Jesus said, "For assuredly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle," those are the little breathing marks and the little line on a letter that makes it into a different letter, like we would say part the dot on the I. "Not one little jot or tittle will by no means pass from the law until all is fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these," you know, they're going to be least in the kingdom of God. So Jesus is making a statement that says, every word of it is going to be fulfilled. So Jesus is acknowledging that. Now, on top of that, as you go through the Gospels, you find out that Jesus speaks of creation as a literal event. He speaks of Adam as a real person. He speaks of Noah and the ark as if it's a literal event. He speaks of Jonah being swallowed by a great fish as a literal event. You cannot read the Bible and come to the conclusion that Jesus didn't believe what was in the Old Testament, because he clearly did, and as did Paul and James and John and Peter. They all did. They talked about it as if this is the truth. And so we have those witnesses. Now, there used to be people who would argue that, no, you know, Jesus didn't think that. But when you read what he says, it becomes very clear. Now, the liberal scholars who don't want to believe in the Bible, they say that Jesus actually believed those stories, but they weren't really true. Jesus was just confused. But throughout history, the Jews moving all the way through, as they studied for centuries the prophecies of the Old Testament and from Genesis all the way through to all the prophets, the Jews believed that the scriptures were inerrant, were without error. They took it so seriously that when they would make a copy, they didn't have copy machines or scanners or things like that. A guy would sit there for years copying every letter. And as much work as that was, if they messed up, they threw it away and started that scroll over again. They were very serious about getting it right. And they did. It's really amazing how they did. But they never had the idea, historically, the Masoretes on back, never had the idea that maybe this stuff isn't really true. They believed that it was. They believed that it was without error. That's why they were so meticulous in copying it. Jesus, clearly, as we said, felt the same way. All of the apostles referred to the fact that the scripture is without error. It can't be broken. It is absolutely dependable. The church fathers, during the first few hundred years of church history, over and over again, this is the scripture. This is the truth. It can be trusted and relied upon. Fast forward to the Reformation, the 1500s, 1600s, all of the reformers were very strong about the fact that the Bible can be trusted. It is without error. R.A. Torrey, who's one of my heroes, just an amazing man, but he made a statement one time. R.A. Torrey was the first dean of Moody Bible Institute in Chicago, and then he really functionally was the first dean. They had another guy who was saying he was a dean, but he didn't have the academic background. Torrey was brilliant and well-educated, but he helped start Biola when it was in Los Angeles. But R.A. Torrey one time said, we ought to get rid of all denominations and then just have two denominations, the people who believe in the inerrancy of Scripture and the people who don't. See, if there is somebody who maybe does things a lot differently than I do, but they believe in the inerrancy of Scripture, then we can look at the Scripture and we can talk about our practices. It's hard to dialogue with someone who's like, anytime there's something in the Bible that they're not sure about, they just decide, well, I don't know what it means. Maybe it's not even supposed to be in there. And so biblical inerrancy is really important. I would not spend the time to study God's word and to teach it to people if I did not believe that this book is without error. Now, when we talk about inerrancy, I'm not talking about that there weren't some copyist errors and things like that, but in the original autographs, they're called, the original writings, the Holy Spirit breathed it, carried along those who were writing it, and even though it was written from a human hand, and even though it was written in their vocabulary and things like that, it's without error. It does what it intends to do. And if I didn't believe that, I might as well just get up here and teach from some other book. I might as well just get up here and say, well, here's what science has discovered, or here's what I'm thinking. I just wrote a book, and we're going to study through my book. But I am so secure in being able to say, when I open the Word of God, I might screw it up, but the Word of God is dependable. At least I'm starting with something that's faithful. If I twist it, that's on me. If I misunderstand it, that's my problem. Now, there are people who really object to inerrancy, and a lot of times it's from really unnecessary reasons. I mean, some people will look at numerical discrepancies. Like in 2 Samuel 10:18, talks about David killing 700 people, and in the same story in 1 Chronicles 19:18, it says 7,000 people. So one, it says 700, and the other, it says 7,000. Well, clearly that the person who is writing it knew what the other person had written. These are public records. So it was not like they didn't know. But once it was put in there, and all it was a decimal point. The way that the Hebrews do numbers, it's pretty easy to transpose 700 or 7,000. It looks similar to the way we are if you just get a decimal point in the wrong place. But the thing that amazes me is when they knew that, they continued to copy it the way that they received the copy, which was probably that mistake was made early on, whichever one of them was right or wrong. And it's like, I would have fixed it. I would have gone, we already know from 2 Samuel that it's actually 700, so let's just fix that. But these guys, the scribes, had so much dedication and devotion to the integrity of God's word that they didn't fix it. If you're doing a police investigation and you have several witnesses, when you listen to the witnesses, if their stories are identical, you know that they colluded. You know that they copied because people see a story differently and you have a reliable witness when their witness is unique. And it's kind of the same way with the Bible. Sometimes the stories are told differently, the same story. That actually makes me feel better about the integrity of the text, not worse, because they continue to respect it enough that they didn't fix it. They reproduce it accurately time after time after time. There are other things, like in Matthew chapter 1, there is a genealogy of Jesus. In Luke chapter 3, there is a genealogy of Jesus. They have some similar, elements, but in actuality, they are different. Well, the best explanation that I've come up with, and the text seems to indicate it, Matthew's is taking Jesus' legal genealogy to his stepfather Joseph, because that's where he would get the right to be a king, and that's what he is emphasizing there. So Jesus' legal genealogy is there. In Luke chapter 3, it's his biological genealogy through his mother Mary, so not a contradiction. But there are people who look at that, and rather than look for an obvious explanation, they're just like, see, the Bible can't be trusted. It's full of errors. It's ridiculous. When you go into the four Gospels and you read about the resurrection accounts, it's another thing where people reject the inerrancy of Scripture because they say, well, this Gospel says there were two angels there, and this one just says there was one angel there. You see the same thing with a demon-possessed guy. This says there were two of them. This says there were only one. Do the simple math. If there were two angels, there was also one angel. One is a subset of two. So that witness either only saw the one angel, or that witness wanted to emphasize the angel who spoke, for instance, rather than the other one who was standing by. It is not a contradiction if you say, I saw an angel, and somebody else says, I saw two angels. It's helping you fulfill the story, but to reject the scriptures based on simple things like that. And with the resurrection story, even though there are a lot of differences between them, who got to the tomb first, and wait, did he go in or did he just stick his head in? You can put all those together and it's very easy to harmonize them. To me, I don't know if my harmonization of it is perfect, but I'm not going to give up the only chance at an authoritative book that I have because of something like that that really doesn't matter at all. You have Matthew and Luke versus Mark with the story of Peter denying Christ. And, one of them says that the cock, the chicken, crowed twice, and that Jesus said to him, before the cock crows twice, you'll deny me three times. The other one just says, when the cock crows. And so one says, after he heard the cock the second time, he denied him the third time. The other one just says, he heard the cock crow, and he denied him. Both are true. Those are silly things that are not going to say, oh, they can't both be true. They can be easily. And it would be fishy if they just copied each other and all said the same things. And the thing is, like, for instance, we know that Matthew was written very early. Mark was written probably 10 years later. Different people differ. Luke certainly had access to Matthew and Mark. So if there was anything fishy going on, they would have got their stuff together. But they left it the way the witness said it was. And I would rather trust that. And I'm certainly not going to reject the scripture because of that. Let me read you a definition of inerrancy. And it's from Paul Feinberg. He's a late theologian. Great. In fact, he's actually the guy that I was named after. His name was Paul David, and my parents named me David Paul. But he says this: inerrancy means that when all the facts are known, the scriptures, in their original autographs, the original documents, and properly interpreted, will be shown to be wholly true in everything that they affirm, whether that has to do with doctrine or morality or with the social, physical, or life sciences. I mean, that's a mouthful for sure. But all of it's important, because there are some people who say, the Bible is inspired in all areas of faith and practice. In other words, everything about, you know, morality, everything about spirituality, yeah, it's inspired. But it's not necessarily accurate historically. It's not necessarily inaccurate. It's not necessarily accurate scientifically. The late Francis Schaeffer said, when you do that, you take away that by saying it's only inspired in faith and practice, you take away that everything that's verifiable. And so over and over again, we see the history in the Bible verified through later developments, through archaeological discoveries and everything else. A lot of times, amazingly, even scientific statements that end up verifying that which science discovers. We don't want to set these apart as in opposition, but inerrancy means you can trust it. But that means that it is doing what it's supposed to be doing. So there are some things about the Bible that we need to be aware of, like, for instance, the doctrine of inerrancy doesn't demand strict adherence to the rules of grammar. Grammar is something that describes how people communicate. The rules of grammar were not engraved in stone when a language was invented. Language use is what defines spelling and grammar. It's like, okay, here's how people spell that, here's how people say that. So there are places in the Bible that you might say, well, that's grammatically incorrect. Well, inerrancy does not mean that God foresaw human laws of grammar and therefore conformed to it. It also doesn't preclude using figures of speech or literary genre. For instance, something can be poetic, and if that's the intention of the writer of Scripture, there's no reason, for instance, to when it says that God wants to gather them under his feathers, that doesn't mean that God has feathers, or that his hand is stretched out across the earth, so he has this huge hand. We have to read the Bible the way we would read any other work of literature and figure out, okay, is this being poetic? Is it being metaphoric? And there are places where it's like, yeah, it's not easy to say. I mean, in Luke, for instance, when Jesus talks about the rich man and Lazarus, and the Lazarus, the beggar, dies and goes to Abraham's bosom, and the rich man dies and he goes to a place of torment. And they have this conversation and everything. Well, I mean, we generally take that as being literal, and that there is a place that you call Abraham's bosom where righteous people would go before Jesus ever rose from the dead. But that easily could be him telling a story to illustrate a spiritual point. That would not contradict inerrancy. It's just like, I need to figure out what you're saying. So in understanding the Bible, I need to know what would be the likely intention of the author. I need to consider who is the audience he was addressing and how would they have understood this historically. You have to analyze the Bible the way you analyze any other literature, in other words. You can't just take it as a wooden, literal thing. And, you know, a lot of people reject inerrancy because people who believe in inerrancy take such a wooden approach. And, I mean, I've known people who go, I could never believe the Bible literally because it says that a guy was swallowed by a whale. But then Jesus says he was swallowed by a big fish. A whale is a mammal. It's not a fish. So which is it? I don't trust the Bible. That's stupid. You know, it's this is what happened. There's no reason. We do it all the time in the way we speak. You make your point. So you can't attack the Bible on something that isn't the point of what it's trying to say, in other words. So you can't also demand historical or semantic precision. Sometimes when we speak, we put estimates out. If it says there were 1,000 people, it doesn't necessarily mean that there were exactly 1,000 people. We would never do that with any other literature, and we don't do it to the Bible. Don't get carried away with, you know, that is not inerrancy. That's foolishness to be able to try to do that, and you just can't, you can't defend that. It also, inerrancy doesn't demand technical language of modern science. When it talks about, on the one, you know, the Bible will talk about the ends of the earth. So then there are some people who are like, well, then there must be an end of the earth, therefore it can't be round. But it also says he sits on the circle of the earth. So people go, ah, the Bible's contradicting itself. No, it's communication. It's communicating what it intends to communicate. Be careful about thinking that you can teach a truth from a scripture that isn't teaching that truth. It's teaching something else. It doesn't mean that it's going to have the technical precision of modern times, and therefore we take all of our science from that. I mean, and I personally feel that we need to be careful, and we'll talk about it next week when we talk about creation and the fall, but, you know, I don't think we just have to say, it says a literal 7 days, so it has to be a literal 7 days. I don't know. I don't know if the earth is young or old. We'll talk about that next week. But you certainly shouldn't say what there are a lot of people who are saying today, if the earth is older than 8,000 years old, then you can't believe the gospel. You can't believe anything in the Bible if Genesis 1 and 2 is a lie. Well, I don't think Genesis 1 and 2 are a lie, even if the universe is millions of years old. And I don't know how old it is. I'm not that old, so I don't remember. But, you know, but at the same time, it's like, what is he trying to teach there? Is he trying to teach scientifically the age of the universe, or is he trying to make a different point? And again, we can make ourselves look ignorant and make the Bible have to defend itself against something that it isn't even saying if we are going to think that the Bible is the ultimate rule of all science. It's not. It's never wrong. It's always important to include what the Bible says and factor it in with other things. But as you know, God lets us know that the heavens declare his glory. The heavens are speaking all the time. So we have to get the big picture to take a particular passage and just say, if it isn't scientifically accurate linguistically, that therefore we can't trust it. That's self-defeating completely. Inerrancy also doesn't require verbal exactness when quoting the Old Testament or the New Testament, and it doesn't require that the words of Jesus are quoted verbatim. See, it is not, you know, if you come up and tell me a story and you're like, today I was at work, it was really struggling, or some guy at work was just going after me, and then this thing broke and it didn't happen, and I was stressing about my time, and my boss was being a jerk, and I go, oh man, I'm so sorry, let me pray for you. And then later if I say about you, man, they said they had a horrible day at work, and so I prayed for them. That's not true. And why would we expect something of the Bible in that way? So if you have, you know, the importance is you get the things that are important. You get the things that matters. So if one author, one gospel writer has a quote of Jesus saying one thing and another gospel writer has him saying the same essential thing, but it adds a little phrase, like at the end of the Lord's Prayer, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. They didn't make that up, and he didn't necessarily say the prayer more than once. He may have, but it's not even necessary. You can't take scripture and then make it be as accurate as we want it to be in things that God had no concern or intention of. Sometimes it makes estimates. Sometimes it can quote the spirit of what somebody is saying and have it be accurate and not be a completely wooden thing. So when you're reading the scriptures and you're like, well, here it says it this way and here it says it this way, one of them is lying. No, they're not. If they're reflecting accurately that which is communicated, that should be sufficient. They don't have to be precise quotes. And it also, inerrancy doesn't guarantee the comprehensiveness of any one account. You can tell a particular story and you can leave out a lot of details. Another version of it may provide other details. That, again, for eyewitnesses, if they all match up, something's fishy. So inerrancy doesn't mean that you can't have levels of comprehensiveness in the way that you tell the story. And it also, inerrancy doesn't demand infallibility of whatever source is used by the writers. If somebody is relaying an event or a story, and the writer, like for instance Luke, is getting that story from an eyewitness, and then he's writing it down, Holy Spirit is inspiring Luke as he is writing that. But it doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit was inspiring the person who told the story. It's telling the story as that person told it, and he is, in a perfect way, inerrantly, as the Holy Spirit carries him along, is relaying the story that this other person gave him. Is that making sense? Is this kind of, what I'm trying to say is, don't be stupid about what you believe about the Bible. I mean, God's really intelligent, and he doesn't want us just to throw our brain out the window. We need to read the Bible, trust it completely, but understand also, you know, it is literature, and God accomplishes the purpose that he has for his word, but his purpose isn't in just wooden, you know, repetition. He's not a copy machine. Now, this brings up the question that, you know, we don't have a ton of time to go into it, but how do you know which books of the Bible are in the Bible? There's something called canonicity. The canon of Scripture is spelled C-A-N-O-N. Canon was a word that referred to a stick that was used to measure stuff. Eventually, the word for canon refers to the books of the Bible that are inspired by God, that belong in the Bible. So canonicity says, I mean, there were a lot of books in those days, and a lot have come along since. Canonicity says, how do you know that these 66 books that we have are all a part of Scripture, are all without error, are all things to be completely trusted? Now, there are lots of good books, you know, written on this topic if you really want to read into it further. But F.F. Bruce has a couple of really good ones, for instance. But the point that I want to make to you here is that nobody decided what's in the canon and what isn't. The way the canon developed, first of all, the Old Testament books, the Jewish scholars had virtually no dispute about which books of the Old Testament belonged in the Scriptures. They had other books. There was nothing that was ever even a candidate for it. Up until the time of, you know, 100 years before Jesus or so, their Old Testament canon had been completed. So we basically take theirs. We figure they knew what was true and what wasn't. Now, when it came to the New Testament books, it's a little more difficult because they're being written and scriptures are beginning to be developed. But the Catholic Church would say that it's the church that decided which books go in and which books come out. And I understand that. I wouldn't completely disagree with that. But it's more fundamental than that. Whether or not a book belongs in the canon of scripture, it really had to do with the fact that whether godly people looked at that book and go, this is clearly inspired. A book doesn't become inspired because it's put in the canon. A book got put into the Bible because virtually everyone recognized that it was inspired by God. And to get a feel for that, if you read some of the books that are not in our canon of Scripture, you would see there's such a difference. There are, you know, stories about dragons and all kinds of weird stuff, teaching weird things, advocating perverse practices and everything else. And some of the books that people are like, well, why isn't the Gospel of Thomas in the canon? You have a book that came along hundreds of years later, definitely wasn't written by Thomas, and it's clearly a forgery. And so nobody even considered some of the books like that. There were, in our Bible, the 66 books we have, there were a couple of books that it took a few years before everyone agreed. The notable ones were the book of Hebrews, because it doesn't say who the author was. And so people are like, I don't know, you know, most of these books, we know who wrote it. Hebrews is not signed. Nobody identifies themselves. Now, I know that Paul wrote Hebrews, and I know why he didn't put his name on it, because the Jewish people he was trying to reach didn't like Paul. They thought he was a sellout. So obviously, he wanted to communicate to his people. He had a heart for them. He even said in Romans that he would go to hell if it could mean his Jewish brothers would go to heaven. Such a deep dedication. He wanted to get it out there, and he did. I believe it wasn't. And it was as early as, Paul died in the mid-60s A.D., and a little after 100 A.D., the book of Hebrews was bundled in with books on the writings of Paul. Last time I was in Ireland, we went into the Chester Beatty Museum, which is the most incredible. If you're ever in Dublin, you need to go see it, because they have ancient manuscripts and documents. And I saw there a document called the Epistles of Paul, and it was Romans and Hebrews and then other letters. So I'm convinced that, but you can see why people go, okay, is this in here or not? There was nothing in the book that made people think this isn't inspired. They were just debating it because they wanted to know who was the author. The book of James was also questioned by a few people for a while. And that was because James made statements like, you know, you can be, you know, you're justified by your works. Faith without works is dead. And so it seemed like he was opposite to Paul, who was talking about justification by grace through faith. But after people talked about it a little bit, they realized that it wasn't a contradiction at all, that what he is saying is you can tell that somebody has received God's grace by the way it works in their life. And so, you know, very early on, James was universally accepted as a part of the canon. By, you know, first 200 years of church history at the most, there was virtually no dispute about which books belonged in the Bible, and the Bible that we have is the Bible that has been passed down ever since then. With the exception, if you're a Catholic, you have apocryphal books that are those books that are placed in the intertestamental period for the most part. And those are books usually between Malachi and Matthew. They were there in the Latin Vulgate, which was the Latin translation of the Bible. They were also included in some copies of the Septuagint. And actually, the very first edition of the King James Bible, which was a Protestant Bible from the Anglicans, actually had the apocryphal books in there. But no one in early church history believed that those apocryphal books were inspired by God and were a part of the canon of Scripture. Absolutely no one advocated that for the first 1,500 years of church history. They just thought they were interesting books, and they are. And I encourage people to read the apocryphal books. They were included in the Bible to give some good stories and some interesting background information, kind of like stuff we would put in an introduction of a book or in the conclusion. They have some inspiring stories. But you also, when you read them, you'll go, yeah, there's some kind of ridiculous stuff in there too. But they're great books, but they were never considered canonical because obviously they were different than these 66 books that we had. until the mid-1500s, when the Reformation started. Maybe some night I'll go through a survey of church history, but what happened is the Martin Luther and John Calvin and Zwingli, who were rebelling against their church, which they were all Catholic monks, and they were rebelling against it because they were like, you guys are doing stuff like selling indulgences, you're teaching about, in catechism, you're teaching about things like, well, when you die, you go to purgatory, and they're like, it's not in the Bible. Well, it was in some of these apocryphal books. So in 1545, they had a convocation called the Council of Trent, and at that point, the Catholic Church decided these books are in the canon also. They knew they weren't the same, so most Catholics will say that they are deuterocanonical. In other words, they're in the second canon. Like, they're important, but not quite. But, you know, it was really a reaction. They really didn't believe that. Basically, these books that we have, this is the scriptures, and they've been universally accepted and confirmed. I mean, and then the other thing people will say is, well, wait, you say they are without error in the originals. And the original autographs is the word that people use for it, but it means the one that's actually written out. But we don't have any of the originals, do we? And that's a good point. But I'm not going to reject inerrancy just because we don't have the originals, because the number, we have hundreds of thousands of ancient documents and manuscripts, some of them dating way back, some of them newer, but they all confirm that, like, there are very few differences among them, virtually no changes that are significant. There are lots of what they call variant readings, but every time you find another translation or another, you know, even translations in other languages, but you find another manuscript, it's like, God, it's just like the other one. It's the same thing with the Old Testament, where there were critics who looked at Isaiah and they said that, you know, Isaiah, all those things like in Isaiah 53, where it's prophesying about Jesus, they're like, this had to have been written after Jesus. And so, and then they hypothesized that there were three different Isaiahs, that they put them all together. But then when the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered and they found scrolls of Isaiah that predated Jesus by over 100 years, and you looked at them, and it was all 66 chapters of Isaiah intact, confirming what we knew. Not only do we have all these manuscripts and fragments of manuscripts, but we have quotes from early church fathers from the scriptures. Like, for instance, a couple of the oldest manuscripts don't include the last half of Mark chapter 16. And you can see why somebody would leave it out. It's kind of weird. It's, it's talking about you could drink poison, you won't die, and a lot of the, you know what people down south will do with something like that. But, you know, so, I mean, sometimes it just got, you know, knocked out. But here's the thing. It's true that the oldest manuscripts, Codex Vaticanus, Codex Sinaiticus, they don't have the end of Mark 16. But there are church fathers, you know, in 100 AD who are quoting the last half of Mark 16. So we have older manuscripts than the manuscripts that are confirming it. Plus you have Bible translations in several other languages that we compare, no significant contradictions at all. So when I look at this Bible, I can have confidence. I can trust what it says. I can believe this is a faithful representation of, you know, of that which God communicated, that God breathed. I believe that God supernaturally preserved it. I don't think he inspired the King James Version. Plenty of places where the King James is wrong. There are some places where, maybe I'll talk about Bible versions some other night, but there are some places where the New Living Translation is more accurate to the original language than any of the other versions. So it was written primarily Old Testament in Hebrew, New Testament in Greek, a little bit of Aramaic in the Old in Daniel, but these in their original autographs are trustworthy. But also, what I want to say in conclusion, two things. First of all, I understand that I am making a logical leap by saying I believe that this is all God-breathed, and I trust everything in this book. I understand, I can't prove that. I have evidences, I can show you prophecy that was fulfilled and how it's changed people's lives, all sorts of other things, historical evidence, archaeological evidence, and all sorts of things, but ultimately, I can't prove that this is God's word. But here's the thing, from a practical standpoint, I am sunk if I don't make that assumption. So I am making a certain presupposition that I can trust this whole book. And my primary reason, over and above everything else, is without that, I have no standard for truth. Without that, I can't know what God is saying to me. If I'm going to think that some of this Bible is true and some of it isn't, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to pick the stuff that I don't like and I'm going to eliminate it. So I would rather include the stuff I don't like that makes me uncomfortable rather than to just go, I will pick and choose. See, I can't be the standard for what's true and what's false and have it help me. Because everything I do that people don't like, be like, yeah, I know that verse says that, but I just don't think that was in the original. I would rather deal with the weird things like that God defends slavery in some places, or that he says that women have to wear a hat to church. I don't necessarily understand it, but I believe it. I believe it's there for a reason. I'm not always sure what the reason is, but I am not going to start cutting parts of the Bible out. Thomas Jefferson, and if you've been to Washington, D.C. and Smithsonian, you might have seen the Jefferson Bible. Thomas Jefferson took a Bible, well, he took the Gospels, and he cut out everything that he thought was true. And then he pasted it in a book, and that was his Bible. The Gospels end with Jesus dying. Jefferson didn't believe in the resurrection. But is that the kind of Bible you're going to trust? I would rather trust a Bible, even if when I get to heaven, and if God goes, I was kidding. Or, no, some of that stuff, man, you know, I was just messing with you. Or, you know, couldn't you tell that that was just symbolic? And I'll go, sorry, I believed what you said. You know, I would rather do that than to have God go, I said that, why didn't you do it? I said that, why didn't you believe it? But the only other aspect, and our time is up, it's important to have humble hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is how you interpret the scriptures. I would die for the principle that this book is God's word, inspired completely by God, and it's absolutely true. That's the one hill that I would die on. But at the same time, to have that certainty, I'd better also realize the Bible is inerrant, but I'm not. And I need to be humble in the way that I interpret it. I believe what it says. I know what it says is accurate and true, but I'm not always sure what meaning to take from it. So I try to do hermeneutics. I try to interpret the Bible, but I always want to go, this is my best understanding of what God said based on my presupposition that this is God's word. But at the same time, I just want to admit, I could be wrong, but the Bible's not wrong. Maybe I'm wrong about the way I'm reading it, but the Bible isn't wrong. I'm not going to mess with the text. I'm going to stick with what it says, do the best I can to understand it, and realize sometimes good people disagree on what it actually means, and I'm okay with that. Because, hey, I'm wrong plenty of times. I might even be wrong about that, and maybe I'm always right, but I think that's what I feel, but I know it's not the case. And so in everything that we talk about from here on in this series, let's keep in mind, the one assumption we're making is that the Bible is true, that we can trust it, but we can't trust our own apprehension of it, and so we need to walk cautiously there, do the best we can to interpret it faithfully and figure out what it is that God was trying to tell us, and the Holy Spirit is an excellent guide at helping us as we read God's word to lead us and to show us what it is that he wants us to apply. And typically what God wants to speak to me is how messed up I am. So I can usually count on that. When I read something in the Bible and it's like, whoa, you're so wrong. I'm like, okay, yeah, there we go. It's working. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your holy word. this holy Bible that you breathed for us, that you carried along the authors so that we could, and it's just amazing that we can hold in our hand the revelation from you and your word. And then we can have it on our smartphones and our iPads and on our computers and on our shelf and in our car. And it's amazing. Help us to never take that for granted. Help us to trust it for our basis of truth. And then teach us how to understand it and to discern what it is that you are communicating for us so that you can equip us to do life better. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.